So I realized that the natural transformations, okay? We talked about natural transformations a lot, and I introduced this composition of natural transformations, but this is really important to understand how to compose natural transformations. So I decided to go over it once more, okay? Because mathematicians use this very terse notation. They use these diagrams in which they combine natural transformations using horizontal composition, right? And it's not always clear immediately what it means. So it's good to go through this exercise and go component by component. I mean, natural transformations you always have to understand in terms of components, but then once you understand that, you want to use terse notation so that you don't write everything out in components. So you have to understand this notation. It's very important to see it in components in your mind, right? So horizontal composition of natural transformations, it means we have functors that we can compose, right? So suppose that we have three categories, and we have a functor F going from some category C to category D, right? And we can always compose it with another functor G that goes from D to some E, right? Now suppose that we have a natural transformation, and a natural transformation would be like an arrow between functors, right? So there is a natural transformation, let's say alpha, that goes from F to some F prime, right? So natural transformations go between functors. But we have another one, another natural transformation, beta, that goes from G to some other functor, G prime. Okay? Now, we know how to compose functors, right? So we can compose two functors, let me say, okay, we can say G after F, right? And we can say G prime after F prime, right? These are functors that go from category C to category E, this composition, right? But how do we compose natural transformations? So, this horizontal composition would be a natural transformation that would go from G after F to G prime after F prime, right? So, let's call it beta after alpha goes from G after F to G prime after F prime, right?
That's F prime, right? Not F.
Yeah, okay. This little circle is a prime, yes. Okay, so how do we go about this? Well, we have to go through components, right? So, in components, let's take some object little c in category C, right? So, alpha at this object C. So remember, natural transformation is a family of morphisms, right? So one particular morphism at C. So this is the component at C, that's just one morphism. And it goes from FC to F prime C. Okay? We pick one morphism that goes from FC to F prime C. Now beta at some object D, in category D, right, will go from G D to G prime. And now a programming problem, right? We have this alpha, we have this beta, and we want to implement this guy, beta after alpha. So how do we go from, okay, so let's write what's the component of beta after alpha at some C, right? Because it goes from C to E directly, right?
Yeah.
So at some C, it will go from G of, because composition is just taking,
FC.
Right? G of FC to G prime of F prime C. Okay. So what do we have? Well, we know how to go from FC to F prime C, right? So we know how to go from this guy to this guy. But it's sitting under G, right? And we know how to go from GD to G prime D, whatever D is, right? So we can pick any D if you want. So let's see what we can do. Starting, so this is given, this is given, this is given, right? So we have something called GFC. We can act on this with alpha C, but we have to get under G, right? So essentially do an F map, right? But we are in categorical language, so we just say we apply G to alpha C, right? Alpha C is a morphism. We can lift it using G. So if we lift this morphism using G, it will go from GFC to GF prime C, right? So this one goes from GFC to G prime C. It's almost, we're almost there, but not quite yet, right? Because this is a G prime and this is a G. But we know how to go from G to G prime using beta, right? But we have to take beta not at some D, but at a particular D, which is equal to FC, right? So we have to act on top of this with beta at FC, right? After G alpha C. Okay? And that's our beta after alpha at C. Okay? So this is how we do this in components, right? So first we apply G alpha C, that gets us from here to here, right? And then we have to apply beta at FC to get us the rest of the way, right? So we compose two morphisms, right? And these two morphisms compose, they produce this. So this is what it is, right? So how to remember this? Okay, so whatever is on the left, I mean, whatever is this, beta will have to be taken at FC, so beta is kind of shifted to FC, whereas alpha is lifted by G, by this guy, right? So this is how you remember. Beta is shifted, alpha is lifted. But what is even more useful is a special case of this. The special case of this is when one of these natural transformations is actually an identity natural transformation, right? We very often have this situation where we have something like this, Okay, so so one way of drawing this would be, here's F, here's the same F. This is an identity natural transformation at F, right? Gets us to D, and this is G, G prime, and beta. Okay? Now this picture is often simply drawn as one horizontal line, but it means this, okay? So if I draw a horizontal line that says horizontal arrow with F, it is understood as the identity natural transformation between factor F to itself. And what is an identity natural transformation? It's just a family of identity morphisms, right? But these identity morphisms are at these objects FC in category D, right? So it's this family of these little squigglies, right? So what would this be in this picture? So alpha here is an identity morphism. So G alpha, because G is a functor, it turns identity into identity. So this becomes just identity. So beta after F at C is equal beta FC. So this becomes identity. What is left is this, right? So beta on the left of the functor F means beta will have to be shifted to this appropriate point, right? And the other one is on the right. So here we have the alpha from F to F prime, but here we have G. Okay? So now we have identity on the right. Identity natural transformation from G to G. Right? So this will give us alpha, this will give us G after alpha at C, right? And let's see what it, what this would give us. So now beta is the identity, so this goes away, and so it's just G alpha C, right? So it's just a F map.
Yeah.
So you just lift alpha C using G, and that's all. So these are two cases, right? These are the important cases. We have to remember this for the future, okay? Now, actually what happens is that in category theory we use an even cursor notation for this stuff. Namely, we do this stuff in category in the category of functors, right? So in category of functors, these guys are just like objects. So there is an object F, there is an object G, right? There is an object G after F. There is an object G prime after F prime, right? So, beta after alpha, well, actually, wait, these are in different categories, right? This is not one category. This guy is in the category of functors from C to D, right? So this is C, D. This guy is in the category D, E, right? Because these are functors from D to E. These guys, though, are in the category C, E. These are functors that go from C to E, right? So these are different functors, different categories. And our beta after alpha F prime, G prime, right? They are in the same category. So from G to G prime is beta, from F to F prime is alpha. Beta after alpha is in this category. So you will often see a diagram that says something like this, G after F, beta after alpha to G prime after F prime. Right? Or you will see something like F after alpha or beta after G, right? Where there's this mixing of a functor and a natural transformation, a functor and a natural transformation. And this means simply that we do this kind of, okay? So every time we draw diagrams like these in functor category, you know, or between functors, we have natural transformations, or we draw these diagrams. But usually when we draw diagrams about composing natural transformations, they will be drawn in the functor category. And this is how you understand them, okay? So you can always translate them back to components using these formulas. Okay, that's very important. Now that this is explained, because we've seen this stuff in these triangle identities for adjunctions. So going back to adjunctions now, right? We've seen triangular identities were between these compositions, these pretty long compositions of natural transformations, and this is the way to understand them. So before I go to examples of adjunctions, because you really don't understand adjunctions unless you went through several examples, right? Because they are pretty abstract things. I have a little debt, right? I told you right adjoint is in the category of sets, then the functor is automatically representable, right? Because we have these two functors, and in Haskell we have the definition of adjunction, which says one of these functors is a functor, but the other one is representable. Why is it representable? It turns out that right adjoint is always representable, right? And so, let me go back to the definition of adjunction using Hom sets, right? So we have two categories, C, and it goes from LD C, and we have in category D, it goes from D to R C. Okay, so we have the category C, we have the category D here. Left functor goes to the left, right functor goes to the right, right? And we pick an object D here, right? And we have a Hom set from D to RC, and this is object C. So we pick an object D here, arbitrary object D here, arbitrary object C here, right? R turns this into RC. So we have one homeset that goes from D to RC, and we have another homeset here that goes from LD to C. Okay? So L is on the left, R is on the right. That's how you remember this, right? So that's just a reminder. Now, if D is set, what's the difference? Why is it different when D is set? C can be still anything else. There's one thing about set that makes it special. Set has this one object, or set, that's the singleton set, right? And it's a very special set. Why is it so special? Okay? Let me pick the singleton set. Let's call it 1. Okay, sometimes I call it like parentheses, right? But let's call it 1. That's the singleton set. If I pick 1 here, then this is a set of functions now, because we are in set. So it's a set of functions from the singleton object to RC, to this set. Okay? Now remember, a function from a singleton set to any other set can only pick an object in that other set, right? Because it has to map just one single element. That's the single element in the singleton set. It has to map it somewhere, right? So it picks one element in the other set and says, that's my image, right? And for every function that goes from the singleton set to an arbitrary set, there's one element that it picks. So the set of all these functions, it's just equivalent to the set of all elements in the other set, right? So this whole thing is just isomorphic to RC, to this set RC, right? So that's what's special about set. Now let's see what we get on the other side, right? So our D is the singleton set, so L acting on 1, okay? So notice what this is. Okay, now if you vary C, right? This is a home functor from L1, right? And this is functor R, right? So if you keep varying C, this gives you the functor R, and this is, right? You take this at C, you get this equality. Right? So the component at C is this equality. But this is like an equality of two functors. This is a home functor, and this is the functor R. And this is the definition of a representable functor. A representable functor is a functor R, right? That can be represented as a single object in category C as a home functor from this single object. Okay? So that's an interesting thing to know, right? The right adjoint in the set category is always represented. And of course, because Haskell sort of like set with some hand waving about infinite loops and so on, more or less, right? That's why we can assume that the right adjoint is always representable. Okay. So that was just, let me leave this, right? We'll be using it. So, Now, I showed you before that a lot of the universal constructions can be done using limits, right? Now, even but there were some universal constructions that were not limits. There was the exponential object, right? Was not a limit, and there was the free monoid thing. That was a universal construction, and it was not a limit. I mean, we don't know how to express it as a limit. So it turns out that all these universal constructions, including limits, translate into adjunctions. And this is why adjunctions are so powerful. Okay, so let's start with the simplest case, a product. So a product, as you very well remember, A cross B, right, it has these two morphisms, first and second, right? Here's object A at B, sorry, B, right? And the definition, the universal construction says that for any other object C that has a pair of functions P, a pair of morphisms, sorry, P and Q, a pair of projections, you can call them, right? There is a unique morphism from C to A cross X called H, right? That makes these triangles complete. So there is a one-to-one correspondence here between a pair of morphisms PQ and a morphism H. Why am I saying this is one-to-one correspondence? Well, if you start with PQ, right, then H is uniquely determined. If you start with H, then P and Q are given. Because what's P? Well, it's first after H. Right? What's Q? Second after H. So there's one-to-one correspondence. Every pair PQ, you know, with this property, is equivalent has one-to-one mapping into a morphism H. Now, morphism H is a member of the Hom set that goes from C to A cross B, right? But PQ, that's a pair of morphisms, right? It's not a morphism. We would like this, if we want to have a nice adjunction, right? We would like to have a morphism here, a member of some Hom set. But a pair of morphisms, actually, can be considered a member of a Hom set, just in a different category, right? In a product category. So, in a product category, C cross C, right, where objects are pairs of objects, morphisms are pairs of morphisms from category C, right? So PQ could be considered a single morphism in a Hom set in the product category. So what would that be? It would be a morphism that goes from, well, P is from C to A, Q is from C to B. So this is a morphism that goes from C, comma C, this pair, right, to a pair AB. Okay. So that's a pair of morphisms. One goes from C to A, the other goes from C to B. Okay? And now I'm saying, okay, there is a one-to-one correspondence between this pair of morphisms and the morphism that was going from C, remember, to A cross B. one-to-one correspondence. Of course, it has to be natural in both, in all three, A, B, and C, right? But that's a separate thing, right? So is this an injunction? Okay, is this an injunction? So what would the functors be here? Because there should be like a left functor and right functor here, right? So one of these categories is C cross C, the other is C. So this okay, so the mapping, the right functor maps AB A cross B, right? This is a member of C cross C, and this is a member of C. This is an object in C. This is an object in C cross C, right? So this is our right find. Right, so we could say that this is right functor acting on a pair AB. Where right functor is defined as a product functor, right? It's a bifunctor. Now what is this? So this should be like a left functor acting on object C. That's what we should get here. Okay, this is called a diagonal functor. Delta acting on C is equal CC. Okay, we just define a diagonal functor. Takes an element, takes an object in category C and produces a pair of objects, right, which is in category C cross C. But it's a diagonal object, it's right. So we have an injunction here. Well, I haven't proven that this is an injunction, right? But you can see that it's kinda showing as an injunction, right? So so this is C cross C, delta acting on C, B, right? And this is C, C A cross B, right? Right? So the left functor is delta, the right functor is the product functor, which takes a pair and produces a product. Okay. It's sort of that's nice, but there is one thing kind of missing, right? Like, how do we these triangles here are supposed to be commuting, right? How do we get this condition? It's almost there, we are almost there, right? Except for this commuting condition. So the commuting condition actually comes from naturality square for this mapping, right? This mapping is supposed to be a natural isomorphism, right? So if we say that there is a natural isomorphism between these two home sets, right? This will give us the product functor. So it defines a product functor as a right adjoint to the diagonal functor. Right? It doesn't have to exist. The right adjoint to the diagonal functor doesn't have to exist. And we know that the product doesn't have to exist. And also, if we use this definition for a product, we'll have to have a global definition of a product. For every pair of objects, there has to be a product, right? It's not always true. I mean, Universal construction gives us the freedom that, you know, maybe there is a product for just two objects, but other pairs don't have a product. That's possible. But the junctions always act globally. Okay, so how would we go about this? See, we can pick C to be A cross B, right? Because this adjunction works for any object C, any pair of AB, any object C. So we would have delta acting on A cross B. AB. So we have this natural transformation here. Let's call it phi, right? And this mapping here, right? So if we do the naturality square with these values, this mapping here is this F map, right? So this is, in this case, this is C of, so the function, so this is our H, right? We pick an, right, this is our H, this is our pair, no, this is our H, so this is H, right, from C to A cross B. This is our pair PQ. Right? So this is C of delta so we are mapping C into A cross B, right? And we are mapping C into A cross B, right? So what happens is that the naturality condition will this will be these functions lifted by the Hom functor, right? So the Hom functor lifts functions by prepending them, right? So what happens in this naturality square, and this will be a homework, right? Is you get the commutation condition, right? Because the prepending will just prepend H in front of first and H in front of second, right? It's kind of, you can kind of see it, right? Okay. So product is the right adjoint of the diagonal functor. That's the bottom. There's also a left adjoint of the diagonal functor. The left adjoint of the diagonal functor is the coproduct. Kind of obvious, right? When you think about it. And you can draw yourself these diagrams and you'll see that this really makes sense. Okay? But the more interesting case, well, there are many interesting cases. The second interesting case is this junction that produces the exponential object, or the function object, right? So, I don't know if you remember, but I'll remind you how the universal construction works to define the exponential object. So it works like this, you know, for any object z, so the pattern is like this. We have this object z, right? We have the object a, that's the source for our function, the argument of the function. We have the object b, which is supposed to be the target of the function, right? But the morphism that is part of the pattern is not from Z to B. The morphism is from Z cross A to B. Okay? So this is the pattern, and the universal construction tells us that the best of these guys, right, which is called B to the power of A, or sometimes we call, I think I called it before A double arrow B, right, maybe this is like more easier to understand notation, but in mathematics this is B to the power of A. So B to the power of A, B to the power of A is this object here, right? And this is B to the power of A cross A. So we do the same thing with this guy. We cross it with A, right? And this morphism is called Ivan. Because now if you think about it, you know, what does it mean? B to the power of A is this function from A to B, represents a function from A to B. So we have a function from A to B, and we have an A, eval just evaluates this function on its argument of type A. So it will give us B, right? So this is the universal object of this type, meaning that from any other object, any other candidate, there will be a unique morphism, let's call it H, such that this triangle commutes. And what is this triangle? What is this? Well, this is from Z to B to A, that's H, right? H goes from Z to B to A. A is left alone, right? We don't change it. So this is H cross ID A, right? What, how can we do this? This is a morphism, this is a morphism. How can we multiply two morphisms? Well, because the product is a bifunctor, right? So it can lift morphisms. So if we have two, you know, if we have two morphisms, we can multiply them. So in Haskell, that would be just taking a pair of morphisms. No big deal. Right? But in general, if you have a product, product is a functor, so you can lift morphisms. Okay, so again, as before, we are searching for these patterns of homofunctors, right? So H, there is a 1 to, oh, okay, and this is called G, right? It's called this function G. So we are looking for patterns of homofunctors, right? Home objects, home sets. So H is a member of the home set that goes from Z to B to A, okay? Actually, I want to write this on the right, okay? C goes from Z to B to A, right? Because obviously I want my functor on the right here, right? And so this is my H. No, this is my G, sorry, G. And my H, no, that was A. What am I saying? Sorry. This from Z to B to A is my H, right? Now my G, on the other hand, and it's in the same category, right? This is in the same category. This is the thing about the exponential object. It actually is the same category. It doesn't leave the category. So G goes from Z cross A to B. Okay? And there is a one-to-one correspondence between these two. Right? So for every G, I have a unique H, right? And vice versa, for every H, I get a G. Well, by construction, I just take H, cross it with ID, you know, and then I go this and the vowel, and I get, right? So one way is always the trivial composition, the other way is the hard one. Right? So, does this look like an injunction? So this will be the adjunction between, so this is the left functor acting on Z, right? So the left functor is just dash cross A. It's a multiplication by A on the right, right? And the other functor is the exponentiation, right? So this one takes B and gives me B to A. So I can write it, right functor, I can write it as, you know, dash to the power of A. I can write L acting on Z as Z cross A, right? So the component notation is this, and the dash notation is this. So these two functors. So this is very important. This is like something that you should really remember, because this is used all over in category theory. Like, how is the exponential object defined? You can forget about this complicated universal construction, because this is much simpler. It's just the right adjoint to product. Exponentiation is the right adjoint of the product. It. Okay. So anytime, you know, when you do calculations, like there is this calculus within category theory, when you actually do some calculations, you usually work with home sets and then you switch functors from left to right. Right? And this is what this whole adjunction is about, you know, you switch functors. But when you switch functor from left to right, you go to the adjoint functor. And anytime you have a product on the left, you can always switch it and instead have an exponential on the right. Okay? So let's take a break.